let's begin. Go to Genesis chapter 2. Even before the marriage takes place, he begins to deal with the man. And that tells you something about the man, because God builds from a foundation. He does not just build on the surface. He has a foundation that he establishes, and then he builds on that foundation. And God makes sure that the foundation is in good order, in good working order. And I want to begin, as I begin there, and I'm going to take you to these verses, but 1 Corinthians 16:13 simply says, a part of that verse is interesting. In the King James, we don't use the word quit like this. The word quit then was interchangeable, synonymous with act. And Paul said to the Corinthian church, to the men, he said, act, quit, act like men. That tells me that a man is more than just having the anatomy of a man. Women should have shouted right there. Being a man is more than having the anatomy of a man, according to the word even. Because when he says act like a man, there must be a standard of acting that is correlating to what a man is. So a man isn't just an anatomy of a man, he's to act like a man. So God evidently has set a standard for how a man should act like a man. And boy, we need men today. And don't worry, I might get a little hard on the man today, but ladies, don't get too excited, because you coming. It's okay, but I'm going to be fair. I'm going to tell you that. I'm going to give you my word. I will be fair because God is fair. Okay? And so there's no difference in value in that sense. It just roles, and we'll learn that. To be a good father, you've got... I mean, when we say a father or a husband, before a man can be a good husband, as we say today, before a man can be a good husband, he's got to learn to be a good man. Okay, before he becomes a good father, he has to be a good man, and he has to be a good husband. You don't reverse those roles. You don't start out being a father and then try to be a good man and then eventually become the husband. Some of you get that slow this morning. You get that tomorrow morning, but a lot of times that's what's happening today. When men are driven by lust and not love, then the order becomes inverted, and they'll start becoming fathers before they're even husbands and before they've ever learned how to be a man. So that's why they don't share the responsibilities and are running from here to there. See, we have to learn to be a good man first before we're a good husband and a good father. Now look at Genesis chapter 2. The very first things is we've got to get our priorities right. Men must understand the priorities in life, and priorities is not hobbies. I'm going to say this, and I've said it a million times before. There is nothing wrong with a hobby. Keep it in the right place. I remember one gentleman, and this was back in my years of running around, but I don't know why, I just remembered it. He had a garage, he was a side mechanic, and just enjoyed it. He had hobby vehicles and so forth, and I always reflected back. And when he was, before he was married, he was with us, and we always hung out in the garage, did all these things. And he and I had a mutual friend. That's how I was there. And it was interesting that after he got married, he still didn't leave the late nights down the garage hanging out with the guys. And see, when you get married, things have to change. She's now more important than the hobby down here. And you're going to learn this, that men, we have buddy friends, but they're never as important as your best friend in the house. She's not the enemy. You married her, for goodness sake. She ought to be your best friend. All right, just setting the stage. Chapter 2, verse 15. And the Lord God took the man, put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. I explain that in a moment, but... And the Lord God commanded the man, verse 16, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. Now this is the beginning here, okay? This is the beginning of responsibilities. When you look at the word Eden, it's this garden, it's paradise. Eden equals paradise. Another word here with Eden is, it is a garden of enjoyment, okay? It is a paradise to be enjoyed, okay? It's not something that the adverse or negative way. It is a garden that God created. Man should enjoy this place. So it was the place, now notice something here with the Garden of Eden. The garden, it was the garden of enjoyment. It was also the place of God's presence. We'll say that again. It was the place of God's presence. Now this speaks volumes when you listen to this. The first thing that man needed was not a woman. The first thing that man needed was God's presence. Okay, that's the priority. Men running around today like hormone Harrys, and I just gotta, and they got hormones going wacky and shooting out their fingertips. They just, No. If God's presence is number one. Now listen to this. The first thing a man needs is not a woman, but God's presence. Now I want to define that, God's presence. Is God's presence everywhere? Yeah, technically in everywhere now. But when we're speaking here in a very definitive way in God's presence, it's in the place in the atmosphere where things are yielded, and it is the place where God's grace is uninhibited from being in full manifestation. We would say in this church service, we are in the presence of God. You wouldn't necessarily say that if you was in the bar room. Why? Because what's happening in here is in obedience and in worship, everything here is in line with God's kingdom. When you're in the bar room, there's not much in alignment with God's kingdom, therefore defining it. It's not that God can't be felt or sensed. It's just that in His presence there, you're not going to see the manifestation so much in that bar room because wickedness is taking place. Is it making sense to anybody? All right, now. Whatever's in that environment is growing in that environment because it's conducive to that environment. So when you leave one environment to go to another environment, you're going to get the fruit and the product that environment creates or produces. I'm saying this for a reason. A first thing that a man needs is the presence of God. He needs to be in the presence of God. He needs to spend time in the presence of God. And let me just reverse this over to a woman. A woman, when you meet a man, or men, when you meet a woman should meet the man in the presence of God. Not in a back alley, not in a bar room, away from the presence of God. Is this making sense to anybody? Okay? You don't go somewhere else to find, because you won't find a woman of God in the bar room. You're not going to go in there and she's shouting hallelujah, praying over her food, and saying, I'm just here for the cheeseburger. Lie, you fry. All right, I don't care if she says she's going to church on Sunday. It doesn't matter. A woman should meet the man in the presence of God. And men, you never leave God's presence to go find a woman. I've seen women leave God's presence to find a man and then try to drag him into the presence of God. That does not work. Well, I met him out there. Listen, you got to be careful. This is why you got to protect your feelings. Men and women, protect your feelings. If feelings are fed, they can get so powerful, they will ruin your devotion. Okay? They will ruin your devotion. They will cloud your judgment, pervert your understanding, change your perspective, and start reasoning away why God said what He said to do. The next thing you know, you start justifying wrong behavior, and now the conscience gets seared, and now you even feel good doing disobedience to God. It's when you're looking for somebody, a man or a woman, it's more than just how they smell and how they look. You've got to look for character. And if they're in the presence of God and they are in love with God and they show the fruit. Well, he said he went to church. I don't know if you know this. The devil goes to church. And you don't want to date the devil, and some have. Oh my. Now let's look at verse 15. So first, be in the presence of God. This is, we're not even married yet. Okay? He's not to the marriage yet. We're coming to that in the vows after a bit. But he's not even married yet. First, Adam, I want you to understand something. What? You need to live in my presence. You need to remain in obedience. Now look at verse 15. In verse 15, and the Lord God took the man, put him in the garden of Eden, dress it and to keep it. And I've been over this. I don't mean to be redundant, but I'll just hit it lightly and we'll move forward. But the next thing he tells Adam is, first, be in my presence, remain in my presence, have relationship with me. I'm your priority, nothing else. I'm number one, okay? All right, then what is number two here? The next thing he tells Adam to do is, you've got to work. Sometimes we misunderstand this. Sometimes we think the curse is the only reason why we work. Adam had a job before the curse even. God never created anybody to be lazy. God doesn't have an ounce of sin inside of him, and he is the hardest working individual in the entire universe. You don't believe me? It takes us years to build a skyscraper, and honey, he's building universes. Okay, just think about it. He is a hard worker. The next thing he tells Adam to do is to work. A man has this. He's not married yet. We thank you for your enthusiasm. He's not married yet. Okay? He's not married yet. And now, first, he has to be in love with God, showing fruit, exhibiting it, living there with him. Then he's got to have a job. He's to have a job before getting the woman. Are you seeing the priorities here? What is God doing? I'm working on the man. Why? He's the foundation. You hearing me? I'm working on him because if he's cracked, messed up, the marriage doesn't have a chance. He's got to be right. He's got to be whole. He's got to be wholesome. And he's got to be acting out in what I've prescribed for him. He needs a job. In other words, ladies, understand that. If you're looking for a man, he needs to have a job. If he doesn't, he's off limits. But he's so in love with me, he just can't work. That's a lie from the devil. When you get married, how are you going to pay the bills? How many's ever heard this? Well, we're just going to live on love. You're going to die. You're going to die. I'm prophesying. I'm not Pastor Matt. Am I right? I know he's talked about this too. You're going to live on love. You're going to die. Just send your funeral arrangements now. I dare you to walk up to the cashier at Food Line or Sunnyway or anywhere else or Giant, and they said it'll be $100, and you say, well, how are you going to pay it? We're going to pay on love. You know what they're going to do? Take all that stuff and put it back. You're out. Done. Next, in that same verse 15. Now, look at what else he says now. Now, we say the word here in the King James to dress it. Well, what's that mean? It's cultivate. You know, this is interesting stuff. Cultivate. Let's get the principles out of this. Cultivate. What does the word cultivate mean? Dress it, cultivate it, means to look after. It means to assist the growth of it by labor and care. It means, honestly, let's just break it on down. It means to bring out the best in something. What's that got to do with the marriage? Oh. Husbands, I know you don't want me to say it and you want me to choke, but I'm not. Here it comes. Husbands are to learn how to cultivate and bring out the best in the wife and not the worst. I even got mom about ready to shout amen. Isn't this something? You know I'm telling the truth. That is really our job. You know, we got to understand women. I'm getting ahead of myself, but I'm going to say it. Women are incubators. What you put in is what you get out. And that's not being a vulgar sense. I'm telling you, she's built that way. She's an incubator. What you deposit in her, she incubates, and it comes out bigger. And if you put something bad, it comes out worse. Pastor, I can't. Yeah, we're going there. We're talking about this stuff. Because we have to understand, men, we got to be men. And we can't always be complaining about the woman. Oh, that woman, I tell you what, I can't understand. I can't figure them out. And I'm and go to work every day. And say, well, I tell you, she's treating me this way. Oh, you big sis. And what they don't tell you is what they've done to deposit in her. Come on, women, I need you this morning. I'm about to die up here. So look after, learn. Now listen, he's not married yet. How many times I got to say this? See, we think of these things you work in marriage on. No, a man has to work on this before he gets married. Well, we'll work on this together. No, he's supposed to be like this before that. So bring out the best in something. See, next, what else to say there? And to keep it, guard it, protect it. That's you know that. But it means protect. You know, men, he's talking right here in a garden and so forth. He has a responsibility. But we need to protect the relationship. Let's take it spiritual. Principle still applies. Protect the relationship. This is the next thing he needs to do. Protect the relationship with God. And not a loose living lifestyle, not professing Christ and living any old way. He's already been living like that. Look at a man. Is he living loose? Is he living immoral? What is it? It's his responsibility before he gets married to protect his relationship with God, to remove those things that are trying to whatever the case might be. Now, he also wants, because why? Why does a man do it before he gets married? Because he's practicing. Because when he gets married, he needs to protect her. Well, I don't like this. I think I'm coming back next week. Oh, we'll still be here if the Lord tarries. Because if he learns to protect himself, he's in practice. Now when he gets into the marriage, he has a responsibility. He needs to protect her. Because he is an authority in that home, and he needs to do what Adam didn't do in chapter 3. He needs to protect her and that home. Amen. I don't know what to do with her. I don't know. She just, no. Maybe there's irresponsibility on the man's part. You know, it's just natural for a guy, I would think, to want to not only protect his relationship with God, but it's also to protect his wife. I don't understand men hitting women. That is so foreign to me. I don't even understand that. I don't understand the abuse that takes place in homes. And I'm going to tell you something. The abuse, I'm not talking, you'd be surprised the abuse that happens in Christian homes. That's totally so ungodly and lays down a precedent for children that blows the mind. Now, I told this before, this is nothing new, but I just remember that we was in Ocean City one time, it was down in Hollywood, Florida, I think. And I remember that incident and just, Lacey, if I'd see a guy coming at her, I mean, you say, what would you do? Turn the other cheek. That's not what that verse is talking about. You touch her, I touch you. In case you didn't get the understanding of that. So, I remember, do you remember this? In that parking garage that time, she said, look, I'll go over here and take it as a meters outside the garage. It was Hollywood, Florida. I can still see it. And I parked the vehicle, and I got out, and I was getting out, looked over, and there was a guy. Looked to me like he was up in her face, and he didn't look. Now you remember it. He didn't look friendly at all, and I thought, what's going on here? And she was out there waiting. I want to tell you something. I got out of that vehicle. I was moving on. I enter in George Overdrive. You know the truckers know what I'm talking about. And I mean, I was moving on. I got over there. How about, man, I arrived in that conversation chest out. I don't have one. But I just arrived in that conversation. What's going on here? And she said, well, wait a minute. He's just telling me how to do this here. And that guy looked at me and he was just as soft-spoken, just nice. And then I shook his hand and said, by the way, I'm a pastor in Pennsylvania. I didn't know if you knew that. But pastor. And see, I did. Now, you say, why are you telling us? So the reason why I'm telling you that, it's just natural that a man ought to want to protect his wife. You know, I thought this dude's treating her nasty and he gonna learn what. All right. Look at verse 17. Verse 17. He said, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that, and he's not married yet. Just keep all this in mind. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. The man is to have a practicing lifestyle of living in harmony with God before getting a woman. That's his practice. A man should already be prepared for a woman before she comes along. Now, I'm going to give you this. See, a man must be able to be in charge of his own life before taking the responsibility of leadership for someone else's. He's not married yet. I can't get that enough into us. He's not married yet. God lastly gave the word to man. That verse there, he tells the man. He doesn't tell Eve. He tells the man the word of the Lord. He establishes something in the home that the man spiritually should be a spiritual leader. Unfortunately, today that's not the case, and many times the women are the spiritual leaders. That was not the order of God. And ladies, if you're in that position, that is not a condemning or condemnation on you at all. I'm just simply saying that unfortunately, men are shirking their roles of spiritual leadership. And I've had women, what do I do? And you have to take the spiritual leadership when he doesn't. Because if you have children even, they're depending on you. Unfortunately, he's shirked his responsibility, but thank God for you for being willing to stand up. So I commend you for that, okay? So don't take his condemnation. God lastly gave the word to the man. He told the man. He never tells Eve the law. He tells Adam. Then it was Adam's responsibility to teach his wife the word. Most homes today in church, the woman knows more word than the man. It is shameful. Today, it seems like men are about as dumb as stumps when it comes to the word. They barely can get John 3:16. You talk to the wife, and they're both in church, and she can just rattle off scripture. She's having a healthy relationship. She's on fire, and he's like a bump on a log. Actually, the man should be on fire, adamantly passionate about God, and he should be leading as an example. I'm going to tell you, being an on-fire Christian is not being sissified. That's being a real man. If the Bible is never in our conversations throughout a day, it indicates we have a very low word level and is not in abundance. Most so-called Christian men's conversations throughout the day has nothing to do with the Word of God. It doesn't even have anything to do with the principle. It has nothing to do with the relationship. It has everything to do with everything else, but nothing about Him. If we never talk about God, it's probably because He's not in our awareness. All right, I'll let it. Now look at verse 18. Here it comes. And the Lord God, let's just read it all out loud. Ready? Here we go. And the Lord God said, it is not good that, say those two words, the man. The man. I'll say it again, the man. Not just any man, the man. should be alone. Notice, the man should not be alone. I will make him, who's the him? The man, a helpmeet for him. Not just any man. Because there are some men that should be alone. Thank you for amening. He says the man, not just any man, but the one. Who is the man that he's talking about? All right, the man who is living, number one, in God's presence. The man, number two, who is working. Number three, the one who is cultivating, bringing out the best in things. Number four, the man who is protecting his relationship with God. Number five, the one who is the man who is exercising or practicing a lifestyle of godliness. Number six, the man who knows the word. Ladies, I want to tell you something. Those out here, say, this is not in here. There's around the world are watching right now. So I want everybody to hear this. Ladies, and this is a sad part of the day, but look, I'm not putting these things in the compartments of sin, so don't misunderstand me. I'm talking priorities. I like one sport in particular. I like football, really, really enjoy football. Well, but if that guy knows more about sports and that's all he talks about, and when you talk to him about Jesus and the Word, and it looks like some film goes over his eyes, and he gets so disengaged, he's not the man. Amen. When you talk about Jesus to a man, you should see a reaction that lights up. Where do you find a man like that? In the presence of God. Well, there's not many men like that, I will agree, but he's worth waiting on. Amen. Why settle for a cheap substitute that'll ruin your life? Right. Well, I gotta have a man. No, you need the man. Amen. Woo, I had to say that. Oh, yes. I didn't want to say Lacey in this. I just... Oh my. Now, the man who is not, the man who is not the man is the man who is everything in reverse. He's the man who is not living in God's presence. He's the man who's not working. He's not cultivating. He's not protecting. He's not protecting the lifestyle of the Word. And he's a man who doesn't know the Word. This particular man needs to be alone. You don't touch him. He's not ready. He's going to create problems. You're going to be crying at midnight. What he exhibits before he's married, he will exhibit after he's married. When you get married, he doesn't have an epiphany and, oh, I'm different. That only happens here. Time do we get on this train? I got to get to vows. I'm not even there. See, he's not even married yet. I want to get down through this here real quick and just even further, because I launched into more of the fathers and the husbands and so forth. And we're dealing with fathers, and then I'll come back to the vows and something. I may not get to it today, but we're coming back to those vows. Okay, I may get to it. I mean, we got time. Fathers, turn to Psalm 11:3. Just turn to Psalms 11:3. Now, this is a man now that's qualified to be married that we're talking about here. He's now a man that will be a good husband because he's learned how to be a good man. He understands his roles. He's been practicing before he's become that husband. Husband, actually means now he's fulfilling a larger role of responsibility. His responsibility has increased, but he's built for it. He's been practicing it, and he's solid. When you talk about fathers, husbands, the man, when I say that, I'm talking about the one that's qualified. He's known as the foundation. When you look at TV fathers, and there's a reason for this, anytime you watch sitcoms, generally speaking, the man or men or fathers are usually in sitcoms created to be as dumb, silly, stupid, the butt of jokes. And in those sitcoms, that is a demonic strategy for a reason. And it's therefore there's no honor, which renders him impotent of influence in the home. The kids think he's stupid because mom makes him look stupid. So on the sitcoms becomes the teacher to another generation that is perverted. The man's dumb, he's stupid, he lacks intelligence, he has no common sense, and blah, 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 on down the line. Well, that is not godly, and it's not the word, and that's not how a man is to be. A weak man who refuses to abide or remain alone will relinquish responsibility and exhibit the following evidences of weakness. The following evidences of weakness. I have three here. A weak man who will not remain alone until he's ready for marriage. This kind of a man who won't wait, he will have intimacy without commitment. Oh, he'll go to bed with, he'll do it. Oh my, no problem. But he'll do it without commitment. That is not the man. Here's number two about a man who will not remain alone until he's ready and doesn't have God in the presence. He's the other man. He will cohabitate. He will live with somebody he is not married to. I want ladies to understand this. If a guy will live with you and not commit to you, what he's done is he has left a back door open because he has an option. He's leaving when he gets the opportunity. If that man can't commit and say, I do, he's not worthy of you living under the same roof together. Number three, he will enter marriage. Some of these will enter marriage, but with preconditions, a prenuptial agreement. I want to go to bed with you, but you can't have my bank account. I trust you in some things, but I don't trust you with everything. So let's just go ahead and get married. Marriage must be built on trust. Amen. What they do not realize is they're breaking the back and decimating the foundation by which society stands. Society lives and breathes on the foundation of the order of God in the home. Satan ruins the home. He ruins society and collapses civilization. This is why Sodom and Gomorrah was incinerated. Getting the point? Psalms 11:3, read it out loud with me if you would. If the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? Satan's ultimate goal is to destroy the foundation. He used the woman to destroy the foundation through the serpent in the Garden of Eden. Didn't happen. Don't take that, condemnatory ladies. But he used it. The ultimate responsibility was not her, it was him. It says she sinned, but he didn't. He shirked his responsibility. Think about that. He did not fulfill his responsibility and collapse the human race. The word father, we've learned these things before, but for the marriage series' sake, that's why we're repeating this. The word father, the word pater in the original language, is a powerful word. You'll see it in Isaiah 9:6 with God and Colossians 1:17. And it simply means the word father means source, and it also means sustainer. It also means founding fathers and one who nourishes. This is all in the word father. The Greek word, as I said, pater, from the root pa, P-A as we would say, means nourisher, protector, and upholder, according to the International Standard Bible Encyclopedia. All that means is this: whatever it produces, it sustains. If a father produces something, it will sustain what it produces. In other words, just producing a child does not qualify a male for being a father. It's whether he sustains what he has produced. Deadbeat dads, we call them. Well, that is being deadbeat. You produced it, it's my responsibility to sustain and provide for it. It's not her, it's him. It's him. He's responsible for the provision. Why? He is the foundation. I've used this illustration, but for the sake of this, we've got to understand it in marriage. He is to be, not always is he, unfortunately, but in God's order, the man, the father, the husband, is to be the foundation in that home. And this is what we often say, and it is not biblically accurate. We say behind every good man is a good woman. That is really not true. Biblically, it should be behind every good woman is a good man. I've used this illustration. I'm going to use it again today. I got to pick on somebody. Well, I'll just pick them right here. They are. Let's just, all right, come on. I know they don't want to do it, but come on. Come on up here, Shane and Chris. I want to show you something. I want to show you this. I've done it before, but we'll just show it again. All right, this is what happens. Just stand there beside him now, and we'll show you this. Okay, now every God creates us, He builds us. All right, He builds us for something. He builds us to be strengthened or sustaining, whatever the case might be. He builds us and equips us to handle the responsibilities He's put on us. Okay, one thing you never do is try to step outside of what we're built for. Or it will be like the wheelbarrow that says it can handle whatever, 500 pounds. You try to put 700 on it, what's it do? It breaks down. You only handle what God created you to handle. That's why we're not created to handle stress. We're not built to worry. Okay, you understand that? I'm just using the principle, okay? You're built to handle certain things, okay? Now get behind him, Crystal. All right. Now get behind him. Just yeah. Put your hands in. Oh, can't you feel the love here? Yes. Just feel it. Now, what happens if he's weak? All right. He's weak. He's not fulfilling his role. He's weak. He's depending on her to be the foundation instead of him assuming his rightful place. You know what's going to happen to him? He's going to collapse eventually. Something's going to assail his life, and he's going to fall. When he does, just lean back. I'll help you if it gets too bad. All right, step back. Let him fall back on you a little bit. Just fall back. Oh, my goodness. Okay, just stay there now. Just. Okay, he's falling back on her. Now, probably, after a bit, I can see her eyes starting. I think you need to hurry, Pastor. She is eventually going to give out. He's going to collapse and land on top of her, and he's going to crush her. You know why? She's not built to hold him up. She's not built to handle him. All right, so now he's coming. Come on back. Come on. He's coming back, and she's going. All right, stand back up, all right? The Bible says, don't take this wrong. You know this in Peter. It's not that, he's not talking about a woman's will. He's not talking about, so ladies, don't take it. But he talks about the woman, because I know what the first thing women say, because it's true, women in childbirth goes through a lot of pain. And a lot of times women say, I tell you, I'm glad the man don't have to go through this. He'd never survive it. Okay, let's get out of the way. I know when men comes to pain, they like to be baby. You're to be running the camera, not... Okay? So when Peter says they are the weaker vessel, Okay. In many instances, first of all, physically on an average basis, men are built in a stronger anatomy. Okay, we understand that, okay? If you don't believe that, put a lady on the football field today, okay? I don't care how much she works out and so forth, but physically, she is not going to be able to handle a 350-pound beast on a line. They're just not built for that, okay? And that's because God didn't make them responsible for certain things that they would need to handle and so forth. Now, this guy has been built by God and equipped not to be collapsing on the wife. Now, you come on over around here, and it says she is the weaker vessel, yes, physically, and also, ladies, you know this. Ladies really need security in coming from the man. You want to upset a marriage, and this all it takes. She can have a job, been working there for 10 years. She's solid, stable in her job. You let that man jump around jobs every other week, and you'll unnerve her to the core. Why? She depends on him to be secure. When she collapses, you can back up a little bit. Oh, man, he's already ready. Oh, fall on me, baby. I can see that. You see, when she is under attack, she's getting weak, and she's falling back. It's his job to hold her up and to protect her. And guess what? He is not to collapse. He is the foundation. He is built to hold her. He is not to always be in that position. He is to what? Bring out the best in her, encourage her, not tear her down, not find fault and be critical of her. He is to edify her, encourage, speak words of wisdom through prayer and so forth into her life, and now eventually set her straight back up again, and they just keep moving along. Are you hearing this? He is the foundation. She can fall on him, and he is able to handle it. Not the other way around. Are you all in this building this morning? You may be seated. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So now, rightfully speaking, it should be behind every good woman is a good man. Boy, I just felt that wave of just... See, you say why he's built for this. In Genesis chapter 3, my goodness, I ran out on you there in Psalms, but just go back 1 minute for me. Look at Genesis 3. Look at Genesis 3. Let me prove this. Let's go back to the beginning. Let's keep seeing this. Verses 6 and 7. Look at verses 6 and 7. I'm going to ask you a question then. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and he was... and it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree to be desired to make one wise. She took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened; they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Nothing happened until he ate. You getting this? Nothing happened until he. A building, listen, you say, well, then what would have happened to Eve? Listen to this. This is God, this is knowing his principles. What would have happened if Eve, even he didn't, and he was all of a sudden. A building, if it's a foundation, a building can be condemned, but rebuilt as long as the foundation is not cracked. Once the foundation is destroyed, it's how do you rebuild? That's why Adam and Eve was thrown out of the garden. When the foundation got destroyed, it was over. If the foundation remained intact, God would have rebuilt Eve and rebuilt the family right there in the garden. You hearing this? This is why women need to feel secure. They're looking for a solid foundation. This is why, even, again, I'm not being, just understand, on both sides of the fence, young men are too eager to find unsuspecting, trusting girls. But girls have to come to the knowledge A lot of times today, because the marriages and homes are in such a disarray, it puts girls out looking for a foundation, and they're looking for security because their father has not provided it in the home. So they go looking for a hormone Harry who's all too willing to say the right words, but he is a wolf in sheep's clothing. He's after one thing, and he'll say anything to fulfill his lust. Remember, lust is not love. Lust is everything is self-gratifying. It has everything. It has the person at its center. It's me at the center is lust. Everything is brought to me to satisfy me. And it is always, lust is built on a temporary sense, nothing eternal. It's for the moment, and it's willing to sacrifice everything for the moment because the high of the moment is worth sacrificing everything else. It is a very blinding sense. And it'll destroy your life into hell. Love, on the other hand, is not self-centered. Love, its real origin is in God. So now love is not me at the center. It's God at the center, and everybody else becomes my affection to see them rise up and to a greater level. And I'm not, they don't live for my existence. Now I live to serve them. I get joy out of satisfying them. You getting this? It's now it's not in a marriage. Well, what has she done for me lately? Well, what have you done for her? What does a woman do or children do when the foundation is ruined or gone? Because the house becomes weak and susceptible to collapse. That's what happens. What does she do in that foundation? You see, Jesus chose, and now we can fall out. It's not politically correct. I'm just showing you, when things are in God's order, I'm telling you, things work beautifully. Jesus chose 12 men and not 12 women. He didn't have anything against women. He had nothing against, it's nothing. But listen, let's just face the facts. He didn't choose one woman in the 12 men. He had others around. Mary loved them incredibly. It was not, no mistreatment, no putting them back. I'll guarantee you those women that was around Jesus never felt second rate, never felt like they were subpar, never felt like they was relegated to some menial task somewhere and just to be stepped on. I'll guarantee you those women felt more valued than anywhere else on the planet. So don't take it the wrong way. But how it was, when he chose 12 men. Today we would say, well, he's a male chauvinist. No, he understood the gospel needed a foundation. And the foundation was going all the way back to what Adam destroyed. He's now rebuilding the foundation. The man was to be that foundation for it to process out of. He chose men, and guess what? When he chose the men, the women was to follow. It wasn't so much blind leading or following a male, but those men were to be following God, and she was to follow him as he followed God. Now, women lead and men follow. I see them in the supermarket, so do you. You know, yeah, I know, here we go. Yeah, I mean, you know, how you doing? Oh, I'm okay. They can't even be themselves. They're so tore up, beat down. Jezebel's running the home. Ahab's, you know, crying to them, oh, what? You know, Ahab and Jezebel. Ahab goes home. Remember that story? I mean, 1 Kings 21, Naboth. I mean, it's an interesting story. He goes home, crawls in bed, grown man, in bed. Because somebody didn't get his way. He crawls in bed and cries, and Jezzy comes in, honey, what's wrong? Oh, he said, I can't take it. He said, that Naboth won't sell me that property. What am I going to do? Oh, honey, I'll take care of it. Huh? She ran that kingdom. When she walked out of the palace doors, it wasn't him going first as king. It was her. She was going out there like this, and here come Ahab behind like this. Men have to be men. You're leaders, but you have to act like a leader. I will even tell men this. You should create an environment that she's not forced to follow. She wants to follow. This is not a dictatorship. I can't ever walk in. Can't walk into home. Lacey, you just follow me now. I'm the leader here. And I say, no, that's not how this is approached. My life in God should create an atmosphere to where she just naturally, she wants to follow. I liked it better, Pastor, when you was doing that. When all else fails, that's all I can tell you. That's it. I'm picking. I gotta get to the vows, and we ain't here yet. But look at Job 1. Look at Job 1. This was a man right here. This what a man. This is the oldest book in the Bible right here. Genesis is oldest in chronological order, obviously, but this was the oldest book right here, oldest book written. And just look at verse 1 and then verse 5. But verse 1, there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was, oh boy, I'm looking for Mr. Perfect. Well, was perfect, upright, and one that feared God and eschewed evil. Now that is a good man. Would you agree with that? When it says perfect and upright, of course, there Job was blameless. He was without moral blemish. He was morally whole. That's what the word perfect means. That word perfect throughout your Bible really maintains a lot of that. It has to do with maturity. When it talks about perfection in the New Testament, it's about perfecting and it's maturing in Christ. It also has to do morally, like here in the Hebrew and also in the Greek. It has a lot to do with the moral, stainless part of the character. It's the character that is stainless. It doesn't have the stains of sin and all of those markings. Blameless. James even talks about it. Okay? Blameless. So he's without moral blemish, morally whole, and upright. Upright. What do you mean? Well, upright. He was straight in what sense? Of not deviating from God's standards. He lived it. He also feared God. That is, he was aware of, revered, and submitted to God's majesty and rulership over his life. And he shunned evil. He rejected the opposite of God's character. He was a man, he was a husband, and he was a father. Look at verse 5. And it was so when the days of their feasting were gone about that Job, not the mother, Job, sent and sanctified them and rose up early in the morning and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus did Job continually. This was a father. He sustained what he produced by intercession and by example. It's not that the mother was put away and nothing, no significance. We'll get to that. Mother's very, very significant, but in her role, I'm talking about him and his role at the moment. And in this particular thing, he takes the lead in worship and in intercession and in prayer and in living his life as an example and in prayer, and he sustains what he has produced. You hearing this? Okay, so he takes that is the man. Job was the man. When you're looking for a man, that's the kind of man you want. Thank you for no amens. Well, he looks like the latest heartthrob. I'm telling you got to get away from all of that. Because somebody can be good looking on the inside and ugly on the inside. I guess I'm done. I'm down the last couple minutes. And so I'll just end it. We'll just exhaust it, so keep the time for me there. Marriage, as we're going to launch in the next time about vows, I said this and it's about blowing people's mind, but the person you marry is not the person you live with for the rest of your life. What? This is why marriage needs to be honored and esteemed more than the people that are in it, because why? People change. Marriage doesn't. We got to love the institution. We have to love marriage itself even, because people change. We have to give them the grace to change. We are not 20 years old anymore. Matter of fact, if you're still acting 20 years old, there is a problem. Matter of fact, you don't want them acting like they were 18. You're not the same person I married. No, they're probably not, and thank the Lord they're not. See? I'm just going to close on this and we're done. We're done. But commitment to the marriage, we got to learn to start hanging in there, because when we get into this thing of vows, even when you go to the job, you are committed to your job or to your place of employment. When you leave that job, let's say you have an argument with a fellow coworker during that day. You come home, go to your spouse and say, honey, I had an argument today with so-and-so, and you know what? I'm quitting. Why are you quitting? Well, we had an argument. I'm done. No, what would you probably do? You'll go back the next morning, right back to that job. Why? Not because of the argument or the person. You go back because you're committed to the institution. Just because we have a fight doesn't mean you leave the institution. The next day you get up and you're committed right back to the institution. And guess what? You work it out. But we're going to learn something about vows that is way taken too lightly. And you're going to find out. I'm going to put on PowerPoint. And next time, you're going to find out how God looks at vows. And it is extremely important. And there is only some reasons given in the Word for a cessation. And it is very rigid. And it's not the Americanized gospel. Amen? All right, praise God. Aren't you glad you came this morning?
Amen.
Amen. I'm glad I was here. I am. I'm happy to be here. Yes, yes, yes. And listen, if words got you into trouble, words can get you out of trouble. Huh? Am I telling the truth? So if words, if something has inflamed your relationship, words cause it. Guess what? Words can also heal. Is it making sense? You know, there's a powerful word, two words, men, we can always learn to say. Oh, it's powerful. Oh, powerful, powerful, powerful. Two words. That's it. Just two words. Here it is. And I want you to say it with me. I'm sorry. Man, oh, I just tore a button off my coat. Oh, it's getting ugly when coming off these. These Versace's ain't what they're cracked up to be. I want you to say this with me. Listen, I want to tell you something. You'd be surprised just admitting, getting over ourselves, and admitting when we're wrong. You'd be surprised. That's all it takes. So let's all say it together. Just the men. Women, just don't say a word. Ready? Men. If you want to be the man, I want you to look straight at me and say it. Ready? I'm sorry. Doesn't feel bad, does it?